but you have to actually get in the car and drive it to get the fullness of that experience. I think a lot of times as Christians, we have some keys in our hand. We have a little bit of knowledge. We have a little bit of understanding. We know what the Word of God says. But see, this morning, this is such a deeper invitation to do more than just hold on to the little bit of understanding that we have. It's an invitation to action on our part. There has to be a surrendering. There has to be a coming. There has to be a desire to breathe Him in and to be active in doing that. There has to be an intention to choose Him, even when we don't understand. There has to be the willingness to take the first step and to get out of that boat. There has to be the willingness to cry out to Jesus. And there has to be an understanding in our life that He's the one who is all that we need, that He's the everything and that we're not. There has to be an understanding that we do fall short. Because for as long as we're trying to be our own everything, as long as we're trying to look to somebody else or something else to be our everything, we can't fully come to Him. Where do you need to come to Him this morning? Is it out of your fear? Is it out of your doubt? Is it out of your disappointment? What are you looking for? Are you looking for peace? Do you even know Jesus? Do you understand a God that is so personal that He would say to you, "Come to me"? Do you know this God? Do you understand that God the Father said, "I'm going to send my Son Jesus, first and foremost, to give you salvation, to be your redemption, that you don't have to die in your sins, that you don't have to live under the curses of this world, because He's going to shed His blood for you"? And then God the Father said, "And I'm sending another, the Holy Spirit, so that you don't have to walk alone on this earth, but He's going to be your comforter. He's going to be your guide, your counselor. He's going to give you wisdom." Are you hearing this morning the invitation to come? Do you see everything that is available to us if we will just come? It is so much more than just holding on to a little bit of knowledge. It is so much more than just dangling some keys and saying, "Yes, I have the keys to that car." It's so much more. There's a stepping into that He desires for us to take place. What do you need to do this morning? How do you need to respond? We need to just take a moment and respond. Father, we come before You. We just want to start with a heart of repentance. If we have believed that we are enough, if we have believed that we are everything, we repent. we lay down those things in our life that we've tried to make substitutes for you. We make a declaration, Father, that we choose you. We're raising our hands up like Peter, and we're saying, Jesus, we need you. Jesus, I need you. Jesus, I accept the invitation to come. Jesus, I am not enough, but you are. Jesus, I have fallen short, but you are my everything. Holy Spirit, we thank you for doing the work that only you can do. We thank you for the invitation to come to you. We just love you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, worship team. Wow, good morning, everybody. How's everyone doing today? Good. Hopefully, we're all doing a little better than we were when we walked in here. Do we have any visitors this morning? No? Am I missing you? No visitors this morning? I'm just going to do a plug. On December 22nd will be our Christmas service. And so it's going to be a really special, a beautiful time together. So I encourage you to invite somebody that doesn't have a church home to come and join you. And I think that one of the best things that you can do is to say to somebody, hey, if you don't have a church home, I would love to save you a seat and you can come and join me on that Sunday. So that's a great opportunity to bring people into our family. All right. Well, and welcome to everybody on the web. Sorry, I'm slacking. We're glad you're here. All right, who's our deacon of the week? Mike Rosner.
What a great word that Kim bestowed upon us. This time of Christmas, which is my favorite time of the year, and I'm sure that it's probably everybody else's too. You know, we in this busy time when we're shopping, trying to pick out the perfect gift. In fact, I remember just recently asking my darling, beautiful wife what she wanted for Christmas. So we all look at something special that we can give to a family member, a loved one. And we all like presents underneath a tree. We all gather around, and it's a tradition in my family. We all gather around with anticipation of the opening of gifts. Some people, it's just it's a madhouse. I mean, everybody just grabs their gifts. When I was raised, my dad would sit on a stool and hand out each individual gift. And we could share that gift with the person that was actually receiving it, look at it. And no matter what it, you know, how we do that, what we cannot forget is that God expects a gift from us. Given in the same way as a reflection of our love in our relationship to him. God does not expect a gift because he's earned it, even though in every sense of the word, he did earn it. But because of our desire to give it, our presence to God is to be something personable and desirable. We might ask ourselves, why does God need a gift of our tithes and offerings? After all, he owns everything. And he does. Giving our tithes and offerings is an expression of our love and trust for God. During this Christmas season, would it be a great time for us to give back to God and honor all that he has given to us? I once read a quote by Rick Warner years ago that kind of stuck with me, so I dug it back out again. He said, "I would rather live with 90% of my income with God's blessing than to keep 100% of my income without his blessing." If you choose to trust God and obey this command, he will take care of you. You know, there's a lot of scriptures about tithing in the Bible. One of them, honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first and the best part of all your income. Proverbs. Also, Matthew, I mean, I could go on and on with scripture about tithing. Freely you receive, freely you give. Heavenly Father, please bless these tithes and offerings we give today. Let your majesty be the light that guides us, the compassion of Jesus, the love that inspires us, and the presence of the Holy Spirit to be the power, to be power that empowers us. Through Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. The people... people that I asked to collect the offering, if she'd come forward. Thank you.
Good morning, World Harvest Center. Today is December 8th, and these are your announcements. Wednesday, Lisa Knight will be ministering on earth as it is in heaven. Please join us.
Next Monday, Dwell is having a Christmas party on December 16th at 6:30 p.m. Please bring a white elephant gift between $5 and $10. Please see Kim Comerford for more information.
Every Sunday at 9:15, we have prayer in the sanctuary. See Amanda Hoffman for more information.
December 17th at 6 p.m., the church is Christmas caroling. Please see Pastor Les for more information.
Hey, World Harvest Center. We are looking for volunteers to wrap Christmas boxes on December 18th. We are also still in need of 12 to 14 pound turkeys.
Are you concerned about our nation, our state, and the Four Corners area? Then please join us the first Sunday of every month at 9 a.m. in the prayer room. We have a prayer meeting. Please see Robbie Rudd for more information.
Dance for Him Studio will be presenting The Dream this Friday at 7 p.m. and Saturday at 4:30. It is at the Brooks Isham Performing Arts Center in Kirtland. Admission is free, so bring your friends. We'll see you there.
Those have been your announcements.
Now enjoy the rest of service.
Say bye.
Bye.
Okay, we need to watch them again because I totally didn't pay attention to the announcements. I caught myself right in the middle of it looking at the baby and just totally missed it. So, oh my gosh, they're adorable. Grandma, Nano, Papo. There is a service here tomorrow for Robert Ralph Diep. Rose Diep's son went home to be with Jesus this week. And so just being aware of that, if you would keep that family in prayer. service tomorrow. If God's good, then why do bad things happen to good people? It's going to take me a while to answer that question. So it's going to be at least 2 weeks. Next week will be the nuts and bolts of the answer to that. Why do bad things happen to good people? Or sometimes a harder one is why do good things happen to bad people? John and Nelda, you are not supposed to sit on that side. You just really messed me up. Why do John and Nelda sit in a place that's not their stall? And Jeff, you're supposed to be right there. You know, come to me for guidance and I'll let you know these things. Oh, they were all taken. Okay. Get here early for your stall. Cheryl and Lois, wave at us. It's good to see you guys. Glad you're visiting today. So, I'm going to read a scripture, and then Pastor Clint's going to read another scripture. This is Amplified Version. It is John 16:33, and it says, "But I've told you these things so that in me you have perfect peace and confidence." Say perfect peace.
Perfect peace.
And confidence.
Confidence.
How amazing is that? In this world, you will have tribulation. Say tribulation.
Tribulation.
And trials.
Trials.
And distress.
Distress.
You're getting a little weaker on it. And
frustration.
But be of good cheer. You're going to have trials. You're going to have tribulation. You're going to have distress and frustration. Anybody frustrated right now? But be of good cheer and take courage and be confident. Be certain. Live undaunted, for I have overcome the world. And that wasn't just anybody that was saying that. That was the King of Kings. I have deprived it, the world, of its power to harm you. And I have conquered it for you. This was one day before he would go to the cross. That was his proclamation. It says one day, and then those that he was speaking to, he would model the cross before their eyes. Not one would stick with him, but he would model the greatest suffering that mankind has ever known. It says he was beat beyond recognition. They didn't know who he was anymore. They couldn't tell who he was. You wouldn't have been able to point to him if you hadn't have known and say, that's Jesus right there on the cross, because he had been so severely beaten. And he is the one that says, be of good cheer. Pastor Clint, we're going to read in Luke chapter 7. We're going to read verses 18 through 23.
So I will stand for us this reading, please.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, that's right. Luke 7, 18 through 23.
7, 18 through 23. Luke 7, 18. Okay. I'm not going to do it the way she did it, okay? Reading out of the New Living Translation. Verse 18, the disciples of John the Baptist told John about everything Jesus was doing. So John called for two of his disciples, and he sent them to the Lord to ask him, "Are you the Messiah that we've been expecting? Or should we keep looking for someone else?" John's two disciples found Jesus and said to him, "John the Baptist sent us to ask, 'Are you the Messiah we've been expecting? Or should we keep looking for someone else?'" At the very time, Jesus cured many people of their diseases, illnesses, and evil spirits, and he restored sight to many who were blind. And then he told John's disciples, "Go back to John and tell him what you have seen and heard. The blind see, the lame walk, those with leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised to life, and the good news is being preached to the poor." And he added, "God blesses those who do not fall away because of me." Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. When Clint was a little guy, he was around, he was the oldest son. That explains a lot about his personality. He's the oldest child. How many of you are the oldest child in your family? Bless him, Lord. Just bless him. I'm the oldest and the youngest, so I'm really messed up because I'm an only child. So, yeah, okay, good company over there, Heather. 10 years old, his mother, natural birth mother, had been sick for I don't know how many years. And when you're 10 years old, you're old enough to remember those things. And there were siblings, and then there was Elaine, and then there was Bryant, and then there was Matt that I believe was just around 18 months old. And his natural mother's name was Barbara. And she had lupus disease, and what actually ended up taking her life was the medication for the lupus. Back then, they didn't know as much as they know now. But it's hard to wrap your brain around the fact that this really amazing woman, the worst thing they said she'd ever, that she ever said was when she got mad at Carl was like he was like a honyak or something like that. A honyak? You're a honyak. That's the only bad word that they ever heard her say. And that doesn't even really qualify because there's a lot of honyaks in here, you know? But see, this is just a place of trying to understand how this woman ended up dying, and there's a 10-year-old and a 7-year-old and a 5-year-old and an 18-month-old baby at home. But on her deathbed, Barbara, they had not been serving the Lord. She ends up, she does get saved. But then she made Carl, Clint's dad, make a promise. And some of you have heard this story, but just pretend it's you haven't and listen again. Says, "I want you to promise that you'll get the kids in church every Sunday." And he gave his word. And the week after she died, this family, 4 kids and Carl, grandma was already going to church, and Clint's granddad walk into the church. And then after service, at the invitation for salvation, Carl and granddad Deweese walk up and give their life to the Lord. Yay, God. So Clint has a daddy that's saved and never missed a beat with it. He's at church this Sunday. Why he's not at this church, I don't know. If you know him and see him, give him a hard time. It's okay. But faith, he never wavered. Why do bad things happen to good people? Did God cause that disease? Absolutely not. But did God use it for his kingdom? Absolutely. But see, here's the thing. The devil doesn't know the outcome of what he would attempt to do in your life. He doesn't know if you'll respond in a positive way to the trials and that you would be of good cheer. Can you imagine the enemy doling out everything that he can to get you off base, to take you out, to touch your faith to where you are no longer thinking that God Almighty is in your life and that your faith begins to waver? Can you imagine a people that would be of good cheer, that when they go through trials and when they're in distress and when they have frustration, that they claim a promise that we need to lock on and put our life in? There's one rock, and where there's deep roots that go down and hit bedrock, Mark, there's only one rock, and his name is Jesus Christ. And that we would come into an understanding that through this place of distress, he gave me a promise, and he said, be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. In this world, oh, you will have tribulation. But the good news and the solid foundation and the core of our belief system is not built on something that can be shaken. It is not built on the things that can even be questioned. There's a lot of questions we have, but there is one thing that we understand. There is an answer, and he is the rock, and he has overcome the world. There's some questions we need to let go of. There's some questions that have been rocking your faith that you need to let go of, because the answer is there is a rock, and there is the Jesus that went to the cross and overcame the world, that you and I can be of good cheer no matter what you're going through. And so this is a place of understanding that God Almighty still sits on the throne. So you have to ask yourself, if John was such a great prophet, why was he in prison? It's an example of good things, bad things happening to a good person. And I want to share something about John so we can wrap our brain around this. But John was an old covenant prophet in the New Testament. Okay, he's in the New Testament, but he's the last old covenant prophet. And so with that understanding, that whenever he was crying out to Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ answers and says to him that, and tell him, God blesses those who do not turn away because of me. And then later on in the scripture, he goes on and he talks about how amazing John is. He says, I tell you, of all who have ever lived, none is greater than John, even the least person in the kingdom. But yet even the least person in the kingdom of God is greater than he is. What was he talking about? I have a footnote here in my Bible. In my study Bible, by the way, where's Brother Bob? I can't imagine being a pastor without a study Bible. But there are hundreds of them in Africa. If you want to give a gift to Jesus, give a gift that'll go through a study Bible that'll hit Africa. We've raised $1,000 of a $3,000 goal so we can pay for for 330, how many? 100, thank you. See, it's why I'm not a mathematician teacher. 100 Bibles, okay? So they can have a study Bible in their own language. And some of them don't even have the entire Bible. And I have about 15 sitting on my desk, on my shelf back there. So that's just a little footnote, little advertisement there for giving money into the kingdom of God that's going to further the kingdom of God. But I have a footnote here that is basically just saying he wasn't contrasting the man John with individual Christians. He was contrasting life before Christ with life in the fullness of Christ's kingdom. And so there was an understanding, this is old covenant, and then but even the very least in the kingdom of God is going to be greater than John the Baptist, because he's bringing us into a new covenant fellowship of fullness. And so it's a place of knowing. There's a little background that we needed to talk about at the beginning of this so we can fully understand it. Now, John has landed himself in prison because he was telling the truth to Herod and saying that it was not God's will that Herod take his brother's wife, that it was sin. And so Herod didn't like that and locked him up in prison. And so after John lands in prison, he finds out some things that Scripture is making reference to, because when he comes to this place where he asks the question, are you the one, or should we be looking for someone else? He had just been told by his disciples some of the things, and it says some of the things and all of these things in translation about everything that Jesus was doing. And what Jesus was doing at this time, while he is finding out this information about Jesus, he had just healed the centurion's servant. The centurion goes to Jesus and tells him the situation. And to get the attention of Jesus, some people came to him, disciples came to him, and told him, this one, he loves the Jewish people. The centurion loves the Jewish people. And he even built a synagogue for us. If anybody, and these are their words out of the word, if anyone deserves to be healed, this servant deserves to be healed. Now, if you were sitting in prison and you get feedback that, and by the way, the centurion wasn't even Jewish. Yeah. So if anyone deserves it, wouldn't you think, if you're the one that's sitting behind bars and you'd pave the way for Jesus Christ, wouldn't you think that you deserve a miracle? Wouldn't you come to a place, wouldn't your deduction be that, by golly, you know, well, what about me? What about me? Have you ever done that? Have you ever compared yourself? See, what we do, we compare our circumstances to someone else's miracle, and then we get ourselves in trouble because it's, what about me? And it opens a door to anger and frustration and some of those things where it didn't have too much to do with the world. It came from a place of your own mindset. What about me? Look at your neighbor and say, what about me? See, now you've said that out loud. You've said it out loud. A lot of times we think it. You know, we don't say it out loud sometimes because we want to keep the face. You know what I'm talking about. But see, God knows what you said in your head. He already knows. So don't let your head be doing the thinking, because God knows. There is a place of coming into an understanding. I may be very well comparing my circumstances to your miracle. And it is an opportunity to have your faith shaken. And then right after, the centurion gets the healing, because the centurion deserved it. Now, those aren't Jesus' words. Those were words of the disciples that came to him. There is a funeral procession that's going, and out of compassion. So here's the thing. Jesus always responds to faith. He was responding to faith, and he was responding out of compassion to the funeral service where the widow's son had died. He raises the widow's son from the dead. That's a good day if you're the widow. And it was about her livelihood as well. It wasn't just that her son had died. Her means of a livelihood would have been taken away from her. So Jesus, he raises this son from the dead. So now we've got these two things, and the disciples of John go and tell John the centurion's servant was healed. He's the one deserving, goes and tells John that there was a miracle of a resurrection life that took place. And by the way, the centurion, I don't have time to go into it with all of it because I don't want to take that much time away from the message for this, but the direction that Jesus was going was opposite of the prison. He was like, let's say John south, God was going north, further and further away from John, and the probability that he was headed back his direction, that he could be able to do something. And for goodness sakes, if you're the one that has been sitting in the prison and you've been waiting on your Redeemer to come and perform a miracle because you were the voice of one crying in the wilderness, behold the King of Kings, behold the Lamb, and your voice was powerful and instrumental in paving the way for Jesus Christ, and now you're in a place of distress and he's going the other direction. See, I have really bad cotton mouth here today. Probably too much information, but in John chapter 1, and you don't have to turn there, but this is what John had professed over Jesus. He said, I am the voice shouting in the wilderness, clear the way for the Lord's coming. He says right here, he goes, in verse 26, he says, I baptize with water. But right here in the crowd is someone you don't even recognize. He's talking to the Pharisees. Through his ministry, and though his ministry follows mine, I am not even worthy to be a slave and untie the straps of his sandal. And he goes on to say, in scripture, it says the next day, John saw Jesus come toward him, and he says, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He is the one I was talking about when I said, a man is coming after me who is far greater than I, for he existed long even before me. He even knew that Jesus had already existed long before him in the place he was exalting as God. And I didn't recognize him as Messiah, but I've been baptizing with water so he might be revealed to Israel. Then he says, I saw the Holy Spirit descending like a dove from heaven, resting upon him. I didn't know he was the one, but when God sent me to baptize with water, he told me, the one on whom you see the Spirit descend and rest is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I saw this happen to Jesus, so I testify he is the chosen one. This is the proclamation of John. So now back over when he's incarcerated, when he's in prison, when it got personal. See, we can proclaim all day long, Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. He's the King. And when it gets personal, when you're the one that you find yourself in some kind of prison, when you're the one that you find yourself in some kind of pain, that is the true test of your testimony. It's the place whether or not, if your belief system, see, it's hard to imagine that John could get to the place where you see as a dove that there would be a dove that would sit on Jesus' shoulder. And that you would hear an audible voice from heaven that says, "This is my beloved son." And then you would land yourself in a sea of doubt because it just got personal. Have you ever looked to another source? I can't even believe how God orchestrated the message, the songs, the message through the songs this morning, and the message through what you released over us. Has anyone in here ever looked at another source when God didn't show up the way that you thought he should show up? Have you gone to other places so that there could be a need that could be met in your life? Have you looked to another person? Have you had another frame of mindset that since God wasn't showing up in this, I'll go after another source of some other kind, and you landed yourself in a mess, and you landed yourself where you birthed an Ishmael, and so there's just things that get complicated when God isn't the source. Yeah, me too. Me too. Because it got personal. And when it gets personal, see, the prison served a purpose because it exposed John's doubt. He didn't ask this question because he was John the Baptist. He asked this question because he was John in prison. He asked this question because his faith was being rocked. His faith was being tested. John the Baptist, we always just think of Thomas. But John the Baptist, when he was landed in jail, began to question if this was the one. Or is there someone else? And then Jesus says, "Blessed are those who will not turn away." Blessed is the person, and scandalios, the Greek word, a scandal. It's the base and the core of that word. But blessed is the person that won't turn away, or blessed is the person. The other words alluded to the fact that it's the person that will not be offended. Blessed is the person that won't stumble because of me. Because of Christ. You almost think that's an oxymoron. It doesn't fit in the same place. But because of who he is, it could cause you to stumble when he doesn't show up the way you think he should show up. It'll rock your faith. Well, let's don't sit there and look pretty this morning and act like it doesn't apply to us. It'll rock your world to the core of your faith, and you'll have to make a decision. No matter what, I'm going to serve him. Blessed is the one that their faith does not waver. Many of you have gone to hell and back with the Lord and things that have happened in your life, and your faith hasn't wavered. But many of you are sitting here this morning where there's an area of your life and your faith is wavering, and there's areas that are shaking within you because you were after this answer from God or something that hasn't taken place yet in your life. Maybe your husband is still unsaved and you've been petitioning years and years and years, and you want to go, "God, why?" Maybe you've got a child that isn't serving the Lord and you want to go, "Why? Why do bad things happen to good people?" is a core question that will shake and rock your world if we don't come up with the answer is Jesus Christ. cause us to stumble. We think that it would be the enemy that would cause us to stumble. But because he's good and he hasn't shown up yet, is an opportunity for your faith to come into a place, I will not stumble. I will not be offended with God. I will not turn away. How many of you have known people that have turned away just because God didn't do what they wanted him to? They got angry, they got upset. I'll not serve a God like that. I should have asked for permission, but I didn't, so I'm going to say it anyway, Linda. If you were in this house very long, you saw Vern. I remember when he was still walking and he'd go back to the sound. And then I remember when he started stumbling in the natural. And then the progression of the disease that he had landed him in a wheelchair. And he could still make himself convicted by Christ. He was faithful in ministering to those men. Then I saw him when he got to the point where he couldn't do much other than just move the wheelchair and wheel himself in. But I saw a man that got closer and closer and closer to God. I saw a man that didn't waver. Now, I'm sure he had his days, Linda, and I'm sure you saw some of it. But I saw a man with an attitude of godliness, a stinking good attitude, still telling jokes, still reminding me about my faith in the Lord, still challenging me about my faith in the Lord, and he did not waver. I've seen many people stumble for far less. So I'm warning all of us in this room this morning, no matter what comes your way in life, see, there may be opportunities that you have that you might lose your life, but don't you dare lose your faith. Don't you dare lose your faith. And see, the Lord is, the goal of God is not a problem-free life. Be of good cheer. It's not a problem-free life. He said, we will. We will have tribulations. You will have distress. You will have frustrations. You will have questions. But the backside of this, sweet child of God, is that he is your faith and we keep our faith. There is a place also of understanding that in the Word of God you will never find this scripture. Your wish is my command. Let's go ahead and really laugh. You're not laughing. Your wish is my command. It's found in Genesis chapter 1, verse 17. It's not found in the Word of God. I'm going to share something else with you, and I'm sort of kind of closing. I'm just giving you hope. See, there is no scripture in the Word of God that says he will not give you more than you can handle. I hear it. I heard it 2 days ago. Oh, he'll never give me more than I can handle. That's not in the Word. He says, I'll not tempt you, or he doesn't tempt us. You will not be tempted with more than you can handle. There's always a way of escape. And that verse is found in 1 Corinthians 10:13. So there is opportunity for us that we end up getting more than we can handle. We think, and I'm going to read out of 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8. It says, we think you ought to know, dear brothers and sisters, about the trouble we went through. And this is Paul speaking in the province of Asia. We were crushed and overwhelmed beyond our ability to endure. And we thought we would never live through it. In fact, we expected to die. That's Paul. Powerful Paul. Expected to die. But as a result, we stopped relying on ourselves and learned to rely only on God. See, God will get you to points in your life. You have only one source. He will get you to the place where you've tried everything else. And there's no other source like the God source. God, the one that raises from the dead, and he did rescue us from mortal danger, and he will rescue us again. We have placed our confidence in him, and he will continue to rescue us. Number three is this, and I'm going to get into more of the nuts and bolts last week, but number three is this. We've got to see the big picture, and I need two volunteers. Brave man of God. Awesome. Wow. That's pretty cool. You have to, Les, but you have to, if you would please do what I ask you to. Okay, here. You get to go first. Okay. So, so, this right here, what is that right there, Jeff?
The dot.
It's a dot. It's a dot on the end. Can you see it's a dot on the end? Dot on the end. Okay. Okay.
Have faith.
Yes. So this represents.
That's a small dot.
Exactly. It represents your life.
Oh.
The length of your life. How about that?
That's pretty short.
In the face of eternity. The point is you get the big picture. Okay. So now I need you to go to that far side. Yeah, let him. Not out the door either. Don't you dare go out the door. See, that's why I don't pick him. You go that way. I need one more person, Brother Steve. I know you want to do this, so.
Okay.
You stand right there. Uh-huh, and hold that. Not the thing, just the ribbon. Okay. Now, Mark, come back. Get your steps in today. Hup, two, hup, two, hup, two. There we go. There we go. Keep going. Ralph, I'm sorry. He didn't mean it. He did mean it. Okay, Les, hold on to that. Come on, Mark. If you haven't figured it out, we're going to exhaust that whole thing. So there you go. the sooner we do this, the sooner. Okay. Now this represents eternity. No. remember the dot. That's your life. Who's the oldest person in here? Mimi, how old are you? 93. It's your dot, Mimi. You can be dismissed. He'll be doing this next week when you come back. So,
I got faith in you. Okay. Little encouragement.
Go, Mark.
Come on, Mark. You got this.
Woohoo! So, Mark, why don't you take over for Les?
Oh, no.
No, I'm just kidding. Oh, that's cool. I really didn't realize it was going to be this long. I was hoping it would be long, but not this long. Y'all are doing good, and you're like, you know what, dinner's waiting, but you know, not really, because you're going to get out about 11:35. It never ends. Hey! Woohoo!
Here's the dot.
Woohoo!
You gotta cut off the dot? You're gonna cut me off?
So this, y'all straighten up now. So this compared to, and this is just the beginning. Now, little bitty section there that might be 90 years. Little bitty tiny. And don't grow weary in doing well. Little bitty, 90 years. Now, if we really wanted to stay here all day, we could count how many 90 years we could get out of this. Compared to eternity. Okay, we're not going to roll it back up. You can let it go. That is just really cool. See, didn't stumble. He wasn't offended. He got saved. So is there an area in your life today that anybody want the dot? That if we would keep eternity in mind and eternity in perspective, we could let a lot of things go. We could let things that come against us not shake our faith. See, he really meant it when he said, be of good cheer, because I've overcome the world. So keeping in perspective, this, I'm going to do it again sometime, but remember the vapor? That's how long your life is compared to eternity. And it's only because we ran out of ribbon, or we could still be going back and forth with the understanding that eternity, my friend, is a long time. So what about eternity? He said, I'll give you eternal life. You're going to live forever, life eternal. Don't walk away from your faith. Let every trial take you to the point of the feet of Jesus. Let every frustration take you to Jesus Christ. Let every disappointment take you to the feet of Jesus Christ. Whatever, every sickness, every pain, every time you feel boxed in and imprisoned by something that may be going on in your life, don't let it cause you to doubt, and don't let your faith waver. Let's come into a new place of understanding. You know what? I've got eternal life. So would you bow your heads with me, please? If there's someone in here this morning and you're just saying, you know what? I've had areas where I'm stumbling. What's hitting your faith right now? Is it finances? Is it sickness? All those things, right now we can bring them to the Lord. But maybe it's deep disappointments that life is not turning out the way that you thought. Maybe you're disappointed with yourself. Maybe you're upset that you've gone through something that you thought was a raw deal. Maybe you've compared your circumstances with someone else's quote unquote easy life. It's rocking your faith. Maybe you're discouraged and you're doubting God. I know he told me that there would be people here this morning that are going to get victory in a place over years and years of disappointment. I feel the anointing on this really strong. Over years and years of disappointment. Disappointment with God. Disappointment with life. And he's putting some things in perspective for you this morning. If you're here this morning and you're saying, you know what? I came in here this morning with my faith being shaken. Could I see your hand? Just keep them up for me. I came in here, I see your hands. I came in here with my faith being shaken. Okay, you can put your hands down. Father, I pray for a revelation. that Jesus spoke into John's life. Blessed are those who are not offended by me. Blessed are those who do not turn away. Blessed are those who will not stumble. So, Father, right now, in Jesus' name, I just speak blessings over the people that have raised their hands because the enemy has been exposed, and I pray that your faith comes into a new level of power, of strength, of anointing, of purpose. That this thing has been exposed that was trying to take you out and trying to shake your faith will no longer have a hold on you after this day. That you bring that to the feet of Jesus and you say, I don't know how, but I know, God, you're going to work this out for me. I don't know how, but I know, Father, that your life overcomes death. Your light overcomes darkness. Your lordship is stronger than anything that the enemy would try and throw at me. So, Father, I just pray right now that you would release upon them your strength and your power and your anointing. I'm going to ask you to do something very brave. If you raised your hand, please stand up. So I need the altar team to move today. And there's going to be more than... So if you're by someone, would you please begin praying for them? Now, if you stood up and no one's praying for you yet, please raise your hand. Has everybody got somebody praying for them? Okay, for Uriah, right here. Brother Fred. Okay. Thank you, Jesus. Stronger still. I will not waver. I will not give in. My faith will be stronger in God. His counsel will be my counsel. His truth, my truth. Over my circumstances, over my disappointments, over my frustrations, because you overcame the world. You overcame the world. Father, you're ministering your life being released into their hearts right now. Your strength being released into their hearts right now. Stronger because of this. I pray that you would claim that you will be stronger because of what you're going through. I thank God for your honesty, but Father, we just ask you, dear Lord, that you would release a fresh touch upon them now. In Jesus' name, a fresh touch. If you're praying for them, just release presence. Just begin to release and say the word presence over them. Presence. Presence of God. Presence of God. That you, I pray you would encounter goodness. Praise you, Jesus. We release presence. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We love you. We honor you. We bless your holy name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. way you come in to encounters with Jesus. We serve an amazing God. God bless you.